very much for the introduction, Tom, and thank you to everybody who's here. So this talk today is coming largely from like a music information retrieval perspective, although I should say with a caveat that I'm a little bit not mainstream MIR, insofar as my background, as you heard, is all from like music degrees. And so what I'll be talking to you about is some of the ways in which my work fits into this growing trend in MIR for looking at performance data as opposed to some of the retrieval tasks that MIR is more commonly known for. So the structure of the talk, I'm going to begin just giving you a brief introduction of why and how performance is typically studied. I'm then going to give you an overview of some MIR tasks specifically related to implicitly and explicitly modeling musical performance. I'll then talk a bit about low-level parameter extraction and specifically some tools that I've developed for doing this. And then some of the higher-level questions that you can ask once you've extracted this performance data. And I'll end with some conclusions, which will include some suggested future directions for how people working with developing music technology software may engage with some of this. So I'm going to begin by playing you two versions of the same track. And I find that cover songs are a really fruitful place to study musical performance, and also just to really highlight the ways in which not just the performance, but also the instrumentation and the production, like really can shape the musical material. And part of the reason why I do this is coming from the more traditional music disciplines, there's sort of this assumption that music is basically the things that you can write down. And that probably seems obvious to a lot of you that that's not the case. But what's kind of happened with a lot of the music information retrieval work is that it's borrowed a lot of that from traditional music scholarship. And so it's like really interested in figuring out what chords are being played and maybe what instruments, but not as much explicitly trying to figure out how those chords and how those instruments are being played, how they're being mixed together, and what the end product is that the person is actually hearing. And when that is considered, everything's all lumped together and never really teased apart. So we'll begin with the first, the original of Tainted Love. And so probably some of you are thinking the next version I'm going to play is going to be the soft cell one, because that's, you know, was really essential in popularizing the song. But I'm actually going to go to a later one, which I think is much more different in its performance. So, of course, the instrumentation here, very, very different. But the thing that I find most interesting is what's happening with the vocals. And as you'll notice throughout this talk, many of my examples deal with what people are doing when they're singing. And that's because I have this belief that singing is actually beyond just whatever's happening with the instrumentation, whatever was happening with production, is really a cue for us in terms of what musical style is. So that's been really the focus of my research and largely the focus of the way in which I've developed a number of the tools that we're going to be looking at. So giving you a broad picture now of why to study musical performance. So computationally, it's useful for characterizing different performances. There we go. Okay. Different performance styles. And then also it's useful for developing models of expressive performance, right? So there's this idea that's been going on for a while that, you know, you may be able, if you study enough performances computationally, to come up with a model so that you could then tell the machine, I want you to play this piece in a classical style. I want you to play it in a jazz style. I want you to play it in, you know, a contemporary art, some other style. And so these have been like both the characterizing it for performance and then being able to generate new performance have been two of the main computational motivations. It's also useful like for people who are interested in historically looking at how performance practices evolve across time or even distance. And this is quite fruitful because we now have over 100 years of recordings that people can actually study. And then also from like the psychology perspective or the pedagogy perspective, you can start to study how individuals' performance practices evolve as they gain more experience. And then finally, compositionally, it's useful to help people understand what the range of different techniques are. So you could do that just going and asking somebody to play for you, or you could actually, if you didn't have that available, look at recordings and start to learn from that. So the way that performance has typically been studied, so for art music, music for which a score is available and the performance is then measured in relation to the musical score, people have developed models of expressing timing. This includes overarching tempo models, as well as micro timing deviations, such as what we might term groove. Also pitch variations in performance, vibrato characteristics. And then also more recently, people have started to develop tools for doing quantitative performance assessment. So is this performance good by some metric? Looking at popular music is more complicated because the performance is often entangled with the musical content. So in these cases, the musical score is either absent or underspecified. And so there's a question of what makes the most sense to relate it to. And also the performer and the producer typically plays a more significant role in defining the style of a piece than in art music. So one of the questions which I'll be grappling with in this talk is how can we start to tease this apart? Because obviously, if we only have techniques that work well for classical music, that's severely limiting the range of music that can actually be modeled. Okay, so I'm going to begin into this overview of music information retrieval tasks. But first, I just wanted to kind of talk a little bit about what music information retrieval is, just in case it's something that's not quite so familiar to everybody. And so it grew out of a range of disciplines. So computational musicology, which is something which started with symbolic representations, so like digitized scores, really starting in the 60s and has kept going. Developments in signal processing and machine learning and people starting to look at music, really building on speech technologies, which were initially developed in the 70s and 80s. And then the 90s, you see people start to apply those to music as well as speech. And then also music libraries. And so music libraries, of course, like any library task, is involved with cataloging and searching large amounts of information. Hence the information retrieval part of the name. So if you've ever engaged with MIR, you've probably been like, what is this information retrieval part, right? And this is, of course, a legacy from the 90s, where information retrieval was a really hot topic, particularly in libraries. And so that's where that got inherited from. So the flagship conference is ISMIR, the International Society for Music Information Retrieval Conference, and that started in 2000. And the research is also published in a range of other venues, including the Society's Transactions in Music Information Retrieval, the Journal of New Music Research, as well as numerous IEEE venues that deal with audio and acoustics. Now, MIR has been historically dominated by classification tasks. And it's kind of hard to tease apart like what's led what, but the current situation now is that the largest industry connections are really with streaming services. So there's a very clear connection between how you might use these MRI technologies for furthering music recommendation. But there's a whole wealth of other things you can do when you extract information about musical content and model it, which haven't been as fully explored. So moving into this kind of like context of performance, I just want to give you a very brief 100 plus year history of different approaches for studying musical performance. And this is just to highlight the fact that this is not a new preoccupation. It's been something which people in different disciplines have worked on for a long time. And there's techniques which have been carried down. And also I want to highlight like kind of certain biases as well. So as soon as people started to develop recording technology, people actually started to study what they were recording. And so those pioneers date back to 1895. The biggest and longest group of studies for studying musical performance were done at the University of Iowa by Carl Seashore and his colleagues going from the 1920s to 40s. And here's a point where I want to pause and just highlight like one of these biases that it's kind of embedded in this work, because Seashore was very much involved in the eugenics movement at the time. And part of what his agenda was for studying musical performance and also for developing metrics for measuring musical talent was to make certain assertions and to try and prove the superiority of certain musical traditions to others, largely the music of white Americans compared to Black Americans or Native Americans. And so that's something which, you know, is not really as explicit, but something that we see now, but something that we kind of need to interrogate whenever we sort of use these technologies which have been inherited. And then in the 60s, there was an approach in ethnomusicology to start to use these technologies to more reasonably look at other traditions, although not without their own particular issues. And then there was kind of a break. And in the 80s, they started to get picked up again by psychologists. And so particularly Todd, Clark, and Rep did a whole lot of studies on the piano, because this coincided with the development of MIDI technology and also with like the Disclavier or the Bösendorfer automated pianos, which allowed for the performance data to be automatically recorded from the instrument. And then getting into the 90s, there was work done on vocals and violin using largely like spectrographic reading technologies, or not even technologies, but just literally reading spectrograms. And then finally getting into the 2000s, there's more computational approaches. A lot of these were still using information which was being extracted by instruments like the Disclavier. But what's happened more recently is that there's been a development of MIR technologies which allow you to actually automatically extract performance-related descriptors and features so that you're not relying on actually using a specialized instrument. So this is kind of a big picture thing of how at least I envision the way that musical style is conceived of in music information retrieval and how performance relates to that. So as I mentioned before, there is a lot of consideration about the musical material. What notes are being played, what chords are being played, maybe what instruments are being played on the performance side, but that's usually a little bit secondary. And there's also been some work done on lyrics. And between the musical material and the lyrics, that's largely what I would term the content. And then on the bottom half of the slide, we have the performance information. And so like I mentioned, there's instrumentation. There is the performers who are playing, like what their own specific like sonic identities are. Then there are the specific performance gestures that they're actually performing at any given point in time. And then there's production. And so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to overlay a set of music information retrieval tasks. And as you'll notice as I go through this talk, music MIR is really loves its tasks, right? So everything gets defined as a task. There's discussions about what are appropriate metrics for defining and then evaluating tasks. And so that's the framework that I'm going to be talking through in this talk. So we have a number of different MIR tasks that relate to content. So we have like these query tasks, which include query by example, such as cover song detection. And then we have like query by humming or tapping, which was very popular in the early days of IMSTA with this idea that the way that people would actually find the music that they were looking for would be by singing into your computer, and then it would like search the database. This sort of fell by the wayside once audio fingerprinting technology was fully developed. And then we have transcription tasks, which are designed to really just figure out what notes or which chords are playing when. Sort of on the line between this content and performance, there is the kind of like emotional mood classification. And I'm putting this on the line because this is really like a melding of the fact that you've got like what notes are being played, or what drum patterns are being played, and then also the way in which they're being played. It's not being explicitly separated. And then this is also true for auto tagging, which is a process by which you assign different semantic tags to audio. And that might be something like guitar, but it could also be something like jazzy. And so that's going to be a combination of both the content and the performance. And then there's a range of performance tasks which explicitly look at performance. So parameter extraction tasks, comparing performances, modeling expressive performance, studying ensembles and how people interact, generation of performances or generation of music in general, performer identification tasks, and then also the assessment tasks that I mentioned before. So going to that like top part of the slide, in terms of the content-based task, the style is embedded in the classification tasks, as I mentioned. And so these are the ones that we saw on the line before. So like the mood and the auto tagging, these things are put together and not really teased apart. One thing which I think is a very underexplored opportunity in the way that people are doing transcription and query tasks is that the performance style is essentially like the leftovers from the transcription and the query tasks. And so things like note transcription, query by humming, query by example, when they're quantizing the pitch and the rhythm and removing the dynamics and the timbre information, that's actually an opportunity to capture this information and then do some further studies with that. And that's something which I think is kind of a future direction for the field. Okay, so I'm in the process of putting together a bibliography of relevant sort of IMSTA and performance stuff. What I have right now is a list of when certain things have occurred in certain years, and I just need to kind of actually encode and release a full bibliography. So if you're interested in that, that will be linked through my website, which is devaney.ca shortly. So I've divided it into three different things. There's low-level parameters, there are high-level questions that can be asked, and then there are recent trends. And what I'm going to do now is get into the lower-level parameter extraction. So I've spent now over a decade working on this problem. And as I've gone along, I've packaged it under this automatic music performance analysis and comparison toolkit. And you can tell that I've been working on this for well over a decade because this toolkit is in MATLAB. And so one of my goals for 2021 is to actually release this as in Python. But for now, it is available in MATLAB if you're interested. And you can go to mpac.org, or you can contact me if some of it doesn't really make sense because it's code that's been written over a long period of time. And the basic idea of MPACT is, or at least where it started, was it's really hard to do blind estimation of the performance information. And so because I was interested in looking at ensembles, I started to develop a score-guided approach, which would allow me to actually use the score to highlight time frequency regions of importance in order to be able to estimate what the actual like frequency and amplitude information is. So I'm going to just play you the audio that the score and spectrogram relate to. So as I mentioned, these two things are aligned. And then I summarize the output to get note-wise fundamental frequency estimations and note-wise power estimations while still tracking everything at the frame level. So it allows me to get information that I can then use to do various studies of performance. And then one of the things I've worked on recently is these note-wise estimations and these power estimations are actually like coming from this spectral representation that I'm able to then use to look at some temporal information. The problem with this is that it's obviously just harmonic timbre, so there is a limitation there, but it does at least give me some information that can be useful. And I see a question has popped up, and I'm going to answer that one at the end. If anyone has questions about like any of the specific details for clarity, I'll answer those as we go, if that sounds good. Okay, so some of the things which I am able to kind of summarize from this is timing and inter-onset interval information in relation to timing. And I just saw somebody had a raised hand. If you just put the question in the Q&A, then I can respond to it from there. And then in terms of pitch, perceived pitch, vibrato depth, vibrato rate. And then I'm also interested in characterizing how things evolve over time so that it's not just getting like a summary descriptor that does a simple mean. So things like jitter, which is the cycle to cycle, or as I calculated, the frame by frame variations in FO, and also like the slope and frequency of the overall fundamental frequency trajectory, such as whether it's sort of moving up, moving down, sloping, and then also like curving in various ways. And then in terms of loudness, there's like overall perceived loudness, and then also shimmer, which is like jitter and it's moment-to-moment changes. And then I have different timbre descriptors that I look at. And these are, you know, anyone who's looked at timbre knows that we don't really have like great timbre descriptors. A lot of it is based on work that was done in the early 80s using multidimensional scaling, where there were like pairs of tones being played to people, like a clarinet and a flute, and they had to make these ratings. And then people made assessments about how close things were together and found things like the brightness or the spectral centroid was a really useful thing for distinguishing between them. So we have these which give us some information, but they're not really probably as good as we will be able to do in the future. And then the other thing which I've been working on within MPACT are these like what I call note level metrics, because as I mentioned, I'm really interested not just in saying, okay, this is the average pitch over the duration of the note, but rather, you know, how does this pitch, how does the fundamental frequency evolve over time? How does the amplitude evolve over time? And so what I've proposed recently is that these kind of descriptors are actually useful metrics in terms of evaluating different fundamental frequency estimation approaches. And so here's an example where I did two different score-guided approaches, and here's the average error that's being shown on the screen. And you can see by the error bars that there isn't, this is basically comparable error, right? Like you're not, there's one that's like slightly lower than the other, but there's so much variance that you're not going to make a clear distinction. So what I did then was evaluate each of these on different descriptors. So the perceived pitch, which was a weighted average as opposed to a simple average, the jitter, which is the frame-by-frame variation, the vibrato depth, and then the vibrato rate. And you can see here that there is quite a bit of difference, quite a bit of separation in the performance of these two algorithms on these different metrics. And these largely correspond to the one represented by the blue being better at these holistic measurements, and then the one being measured by the temporal, the one with the red was better at the holistic estimates. The one with the blue was better with the holistic estimates, and the one with the red was better with the temporal estimates. And so one of the things which this is sort of responding to as well within this idea of like content-based retrieval, if you're only interested in getting the notes which are being quantized, then this stuff doesn't matter, right? Like if you just need to know that it's an A4, these kind of differences are not going to make or break anything. But if you're interested in looking at the exact tuning of that A4, then these things do become a lot more important. And if you're interested in saying, okay, while the person is singing A4, you know, are they changing in some way over time, maybe to kind of like increase the tension to get to the next note, then this becomes even more important. And then the final kind of big part of this that I've worked on is encoding. And this is an incredibly busy slide, but I just wanted to kind of give you a visualization of there's two approaches here, a table-based and an XML approach. So there's a symbolic representation called humdrum, which is used in computational musicology. It allows you to encode information about the notes that are being played and the durations for the notes. So it's basically score information. And what I did is I extended that with a number of descriptors, which allow you to encode the summaries of what's happening at each note with respect to the perceived pitch or the vibrato depth or the vibrato rate. This is also useful because you can do summaries at the beat level or also at the measure level, but it doesn't actually allow you to encode the frame-wise data. And so I also developed an extension to the Music Encoding Initiative format, which is in XML. It's less, like music XML is definitely more used in the industry. Within the MIR community, there's been a fair bit of attention paid to the development of the Music Encoding Initiative, just because it's been done in a way that's allowed people to capture, particularly those working on like critical editions for scores, like a lot of information about the different ways that music is encoded and not just the content. And so because it's much easier to kind of add into this framework, I chose this for the MEI for the XML-based approach. And so you can see here at the bottom that there's the continuous information that's being encoded. And so that's useful in terms of like sharing this information with other people. And also just generally this encoding with the content allows for like more sophisticated modeling of what's going on. What happens a lot is that people will only encode the data just in relation to the measure or just even sometimes in relation to like absolute time in the recording. And so when you actually encode this with the musical content, you can ask just more detailed questions about how the relationship is between the performance and the content. Okay, I'm going to start moving into the examples, but the last thing I wanted to mention was the most recent thing is that I've been incorporating source separation to get away from the score. And so I've been using OpenOnMix. There has been a range of different techniques developed in MIR, but I've found the OpenOnMix to be the best one to use at the moment. And then what I do is I take it, the vocals, which come out of open non-mix, because I'm always interested in the vocals, and put it into this freeware called Tony, which actually does a pretty good job of segmenting the stream into notes and then providing a FO trace. And then it goes back, then it goes into Ampac to create these spectral representations. And then I've been doing work looking at tempo and pitch height and jitter, spectral centroid and spectral flux. Okay, so on to the high level questions and then some brief conclusions. So the higher level questions are these things like performer identity, expressive performance, vocal style, ensembles, etc. And I'm going to highlight a few things I've done in this area. And I can, if anyone has any questions in the Q&A, I can talk about other work as well that other people have done. So a few years ago, I did this work on singer identification. And this was within the classical tradition, using the opening of Schubert's Ave Maria.
Ave Maria.
And, okay, hang on. And what I did here was I was interested in seeing whether there was sufficient self-consistency across different performances that you could identify the performers. And then I was also interested in looking at whether this differed from looking at different parameters. And so I had six singers who are professionals and six who are undergraduate vocal majors. I had them sing three times a cappella and three times with accompaniment that they listened to on headphones. And then I used a support vector machine with threefold cross-validation in order to, on the task of identifying which singer was which. So I would train on two examples from each singer and then test on the third within the a cappella and accompanied versions. And so here's the results. And so what you can see is that generally there's this pretty good performance when you use all of the data, either for the professionals or for the undergraduates. But actually, if you only look at timbre, there's increases in performance. So generally, people are highly identifiable just by the, you know, it was essentially the structure of their vocal track. And as you add in different performance parameters, they become less identifiable, in part because they're kind of all striving to do a similar thing. But within those performance parameters, it was definitely easier to identify the undergraduates in terms of timing and loudness than it was for the professionals. And with the pitch, it was actually harder to identify the undergraduates, not so much because it was both a combination of them kind of being more variable against themselves throughout that. So generally, you know, as you would expect, somebody's like actual physicality is highly identifiable, but then it's also kind of useful to look at like how much you need to look at pitch or timing or loudness in terms of what you want to model if you want to say make one singer sound like another singer. I also did some work on expressive performance. Basically, I was looking at like the drift in tuning, the impact of musical context, the impact of accompaniment and consistency. I found that there was a large amount of drift in solo singing because ascending semitones tended to be larger than descending. In terms of musical context, there was this tendency for my undergraduates to like really raise the leading tone. So like if you're like in C major and you're on the B going to the C to really increase that tension. And then with the ensembles, they actually tended towards just tuning at cadences. In terms of accompaniments, the non-professionals adjusted their tuning to accompaniment more than professionals. And generally the professionals were more consistent both with themselves and with each other. The big takeaway, however, from this work, which I was doing using linear regression, was that the R-squared values across all of these experiments trying to relate performance data to the musical context were like really low. And so there was a lot of variability that wasn't being accounted for. And so this kind of speaks to some of the complications of modeling expressive performance, and then maybe trying to figure out, well, what are the things that are actually worth even trying to model, because there's a lot of variability that happens. And then in terms of vocal style, I've recently been doing some work looking at Rihanna's Anti-album from 2016, because it's a really nice example of a single singer looking at, working with her voice in different ways. And I'm less concerned with this in terms of like any single performance that Rihanna gave in the studio, and more just what was the output that she curated with her producer in order to release. So I'm going to play you the examples that I've been looking at. So the first two kind of, she's using a particular kind of like using her like Caribbean like accent more so than in other tracks.
I come fluttering from Neverland, time can never stop me, no. You tomorrow must leave a decoration. You mistaken my love, I brought for you for foundation.
And the next two, she's a little more emotionally raw.
And try to buy your pretty heart with a price too high. You take me higher, higher than I've ever been, babe.
So there is a difference between the tempo here, like the emotionally raw ones are slower than the ones with her accent. But in terms of the actual pitch characteristics, the jitter, you can see the values are a lot higher for that kind of like emotional one than the one that's closer to speech. I also looked at some spectral descriptors, and there is a difference in terms of the brightness. So in the speech, in the more speech-based one as opposed to the more emotional one, the spectroid is a lot higher. So this is very preliminary exploratory work, but the goal with this is both to kind of break out of the score-based focused within AMPAC, and also to start to kind of explore what kind of descriptors are useful for looking at different parts of vocal style. And then finally, just briefly about assessment and generation. The only thing I want to mention here is that we've seen these trends come up as we've sort of moved in MIR from like classic machine learning approaches to deep learning. And, you know, we know that deep learning is really powerful, particularly if you have a lot of data. But what we've lost is a lot of the interpretability that we had when we were handcrafting features. And so I think one of the challenges going forward, particularly for performance generation, is to actually figure out ways to tease apart this information within the deep models. So like, for example, you have like the work being done at Magenta at Google, where they'll train on a lot of like, say, piano jazz performances, and then they'll generate new piano jazz performances. And there, they're generating both the musical notes and the way in which they're being played. And that is useful if you want to just generate audio. But if you want to actually apply that in various ways, to ask questions about what people do when they perform, to have a knob to make it like the same notes, but a little bit, you know, more asynchronous or less or whatever kind of thing you want to do, you really need to be able to kind of interpret those models much more. And then the final thing I just wanted to mention, just going back to this bias and assumption thing, is that, as I mentioned before, MIR adopted the traditional conception of the musical work. So we see a lot of note-based analysis and performance, looking at deviations from a score. In the transcription and query task, the musical content is the item of interest. And then in cover songs, it's largely kind of working with this legal concept of a musical work for copyright and infringement purposes, although we are starting to see issues of performance coming into those cases in various ways. And then also there's this prioritization of the composer over the performer and the producer. And I just wanted to mention that this connects to some broader conversations that are happening in musicology and music theory about whose labor is valued. And so I have some authors listed at the bottom of the screen there who you could look at. And there's also a bibliography at the end, and I'll be posting these slides on my website. And there's also a couple of groups which have been putting out information like bibliographies and stuff that can be useful if you're interested in digging into this. So in conclusion, music performance is implicitly modeled in MIR classification, query and transcription tasks. But there's also been explicit approaches for extracting and modeling music performance data that I've developed. The classic machine learning approaches offer us interpretability, but they're suffering from a lack of data. The generative models, as I mentioned, jointly model the musical material with how it's played, allowing for unlabeled data sets to be used. But then one of these challenges that I really think is going to be key moving forward is how can we tease apart the information in generative models to allow for control of specific parameters. And then finally, just for future directions, so MIR offers tools for understanding and modeling musical content. The focus has been on the musical material rather than the way in which it's been played. So one of the outstanding questions I find is like, how do we leverage this existing technology to model the way performers and producers shape the musical material? And then if any of you on the music technology software side are interested in engaging with MIR researchers for collaboration, I think a couple of really useful places for this could be in terms of use cases. MIR is very use case driven, and most of the current use cases derive from the historical focus on content-based recommendation. And so that's why we've ended up seeing a lot of things related to streaming. And then also data. MIR is data driven, and it currently lacks large data sets with either isolated performance information or explicitly labeled performance information. So I just wanted to thank you for your attention. And let me know if you have any questions. Okay, so Dan, you had said, do you think that putting timbre in the not content category has to do with a music history that predates recorded audio? Yeah, I mean, timbre is like, you know, because we just kind of look at the musical scores, and that doesn't include anything other than like which instrument is playing, that's definitely something that's been inherited. I mean, there's definitely like whole pedagogies around timbre and how you play instruments and how you get certain sounds. But because that information, when it has been recorded, has been separate from the musical scores, it's not really been engaged with as much. Okay. And then Akash asked, for the performer vocal classifications, is there any additional pre-processing of the data you're doing by any chance? So for that example that I gave with the Ave Maria, I actually had recorded all of the singers, so they were very clean recordings. In terms of what I've been working on with the style in Rihanna, I've just been trying to tune the source separation as well as I can in order to get a clean sounding vocal. But there hasn't been really much in terms of pre-processing other than that. Yeah, so in terms of percussive and enharmonic material, I think it's definitely important, and particularly with the voice, right? Because there's so much that's happening in the voice that is these kind of like, non-inharmonic noisy things. I'm trying to figure out a way to like reasonably track that stuff in relation to what I do know about what's happening with the harmonic material, because you can anticipate that they will at least temporally align with certain things, but I don't have a particularly robust way of doing that yet. Okay. So in terms of the question about automatic guitar transcription, so, I mean, I know that there's definitely like better technologies coming out, and I feel like this is actually one of those places where deep learning will really help, because there was a potential to have enough data to actually learn from it. And then because the output can be really clearly defined, you know, I think that this is actually largely a data problem right now, although that's not my area of research. So there could be some complexities that I'm not actually thinking of right now. So there's a question from Terry about the history of computational music performance and books or resources I can recommend. I'm actually like teaching a course on this right now. So if you, I can put my email in the chat if anybody has any questions about anything. Or wants any additional resources, just shoot me an email and I can send those to you. And then Domenico asked, classification results with timbre are really interesting. Do you have any suggestions for particularly good measures and real-time libraries for timbre-aware feature extraction? Maybe even onset detection. I'm currently working with Orbio and PD Tembred that I'm porting for VST. I found Essentia is actually quite good. And they just released, they're in C++. They also just released like a JavaScript library. LibRosa has some stuff, but it's still kind of hit or miss because it's very much crowdsourced and not like funded by a specific grant or anything. But those could be some additional things that might be useful. Okay, so I think I got all. Oh, yeah, I see another one. Okay, Nolan, did I miss you? Okay, so where do you think we need to go to find truly groovy quantization methods? I mean, I feel like this is actually part of the challenge, right? Because it's like, what you probably need is to be able to like model things with enough data that you're not just getting an average, but you're also getting like some kind of range around those average points so that you could have like a knob which would allow you to adjust it in a meaningful way and not just globally saying, I'm going to offset everything by so many milliseconds, but maybe more like, okay, I know that the downbeats have to be fairly tight, but then, you know, the backbeat might have a wider range to it or something like that. So I think that this is definitely an area that needs some work. Okay, and how good does the sample quality have to be to extract meaningful results? How much noise and reverberation affect the results? So I didn't actually describe my graphs very well with those note metrics, but what those four different versions were under different reverberant conditions. And so let me just go back to this for a sec. So this was like the anechoic condition. And then it was the original anechoic recordings. I convolved them with different room responses. And so this is that 3.6 meters, 7.7. and 11. And so you can see there's a degradation in quality, but it's not terrible. I mean, certainly some of the things, you know, like this, the algorithm represented by the red doesn't do as well, but for the first three versions for the blue here, it's actually fairly good and only really degrades at 11 meters.